This is the wall which surrounds the Sencata gas plant in El Alto, Bolivia, the city which rests just above the country's political capital of La Paz. These are the names of the 10 individuals, the victims who were killed in what's now known as the Sencata Massacre, which took place on November 19th, 2019, just days following the installation of a military junta government led by Jeanine Áñez, after the ouster of the country's democratically elected president, Evo Morales. The incident marked one of the deadliest to occur that November, a month which is now known as the second most lethal in the entirety of Bolivia's 40 years as a democracy. Human rights attorney Thomas Becker has conducted interviews with dozens of survivors and family members of the victims killed in Sencata.
So when Áñez took power, she came to power on November 12th. That week was incredibly deadly for Bolivians. On the 14th, the government, Áñez, passed a decree 4078. They've kind of spray painted it or painted it on the wall here, which gave immunity to the soldiers, which allowed the soldiers to kill people and said that they would not be held responsible. The following day, they carried out the massacre in Sacaba. And then, 4 days later, they cut out the second massacre in her first week here in Sencata.
Y esa mañana vi que habían helicópteros volando por el aire. Y no sabía qué ocurriría. Bueno, tenía miedo de que pasara algo también, pero no pensé que fuera tan trágico.
Remedios Etaño's brother, Milton, was one of the young men gathered outside of Sencata that day.
Me imagino lo que mi hermano ha sufrido también en ese momento. Lo que haya visto, todo lo fue trágico en ese momento lo que haya sucedido.
Milton and other Sencata locals had convened outside of the gas plant to mourn the deaths of those the military had killed just 4 days earlier, on November 15th, in Sacaba, capital of Bolivia's Chapare region.
On the night of the 18th, Áñez's government deployed the military, put them inside the plant where they stayed overnight. And just to give a little context, this is the main outlet into El Alto and into La Paz from the south. So historically, people have protested here and set up blockades here for decades. And they'd been protesting since Áñez took power outside the plant. But on the 18th, she mobilized the military, sent them into the plant. And the following morning, the military shot at the vigil outside. People were based in different spots all along the plant. Over here is the Extranca, which is a major kind of commercial center. A lot of the informal market, a lot of trading takes place there. So there were people there organized, one, selling things, but also blockading. When the military left the plant, they kind of went into the neighborhoods, and you can see over here, there's bullet holes all along the median here and into the neighborhood. And so what they did is they left and they spread out all along these kind of major side roads, went into people's homes, threw gas into the homes, and people quite literally crawled out their windows. And a lot of the soldiers, according to the witnesses we spoke to, the soldiers went inside and climbed to the top and used it to position and shoot at people as they ran.
Milton was among those hit.
Cuando llegué a casa me llamaron y me dijeron que mi hermano estaba mal, que tenía un impacto de bala, que se encontraba en estado de coma y que era muy difícil que se pueda recuperar. Y esa tarde fuimos al hospital y había mucha gente. Esa gente me apoyó. Eran los vecinos. Nos ayudaron.
3 days after he was brought to the hospital, Milton died. According to the military government, Sencata locals like him were responsible for shooting themselves that day.
Me encantaría aclarar que del ejército no salió un solo proyectil.
El gobierno indica, siempre dice que entre ellos se mataron. Pero no fue así. Porque si hubiera sido así, esa gente Esa gente realmente me ayudó. El gobierno no hizo nada. No hizo nada. No nos ayudó.
What is the narrative the government has laid out regarding the events, the massacre which took place that day, and how has your analysis of, for example, the bullet markings along the median and around the area here challenged the government's line?
Well, I mean, the government, it's almost kind of shocking, the response. They've said they did not shoot a single bullet. The Minister of Defense has said they've not shot a single bullet. There's video evidence of them shooting bullets. You'll see all along the median, there are quite literally hundreds of bullet holes in the median. If you go to the other side of the median, there's nothing. There's bullet holes in buildings all along here, all leading from inside the plant and out. So the government's narrative is that the people either, they shot themselves and that the military didn't do any shooting. Of course, the bullets show something quite different. And they've said, you know, this was the same narrative that they used in Sakaba, that they shot themselves, that it's the fault of the MAS party. They've said that they shot themselves to make the government look bad.
Official medical reports were forged in order to support the military's claims of innocence. As if losing her brother was not enough, Remedio would later have to fight for the truth about his death to come to light.
Se parcializaron porque vi en el IDIF cuando le tuvieron que hacer el estudio forense a mi hermano. El IDIF dijo que no era una bala. Y por suerte fue mi primo ahí y vio la bala y dijo que era una bala militar. Porque él conocía de balas, entonces dijo que era una bala militar. Y me dijeron también que trataron de ocultar los IDIF esa bala, diciendo que solo había sido un impacto por un arma contundente, pero no por una bala. Y bueno, no solo eso. También vi que en el hospital japonés también habían hecho un informe en el que decía que los heridos y los que habían recibido un impacto no era por bala, sino que era por cualquier otro objeto contundente, pero no por bala. Y mi hermano realmente murió por un impacto de bala. Entonces yo les dije, me dijeron a mí que a mi hermano le habían impactado de bala. Y los del hospital se asombraron. Y la gente empezó a exigir más porque realmente me dijeron eso en el hospital. Hasta que fue al forense, entonces confirmé que sí, realmente fue una bala. Mientras el gobierno habla que no fue una bala militar, que ellos no dispararon ni un proyectil, pero es una mentira, es una mentira.
The military government further claimed that the demonstrators were terrorists seeking to blow up the Sencata gas plant.
But where the gas is located is quite literally a kilometer or two that in that direction away from where this conflict took place. So if people actually did want to blow up the plant, they would just have to march around to the other side and break down the wall there. But what they did is they were along this side, far away from where the plant would blow up. What the government has said is that they used dynamite to try to blow up the plant. We've spoken to the fiscales, the prosecutors, who found no sticks of dynamite, no proof of dynamite. It's just been the narrative they've used. Protesters did break the walls of the plant. They quite literally pushed them down. There's video evidence of this. But according to dozens of people with whom we spoke, they did it in response to soldiers who took bodies and started dragging them into the plants. People were really frightened that they would disappear. Unfortunately, in Latin America, there's a rough history of disappearing people. And so people got scared they were disappearing the bodies and pushed down, quite literally pushed the wall down to the plant.
Those claims line up with what witnesses told Remedio happened to her brother in the moments after the military shot him.
Me contaban de que en el momento en el que le habían impactado a mi hermano, se lo querían llevar el cuerpo, los policías. Y gracias a la gente, no dejaron que se lo llevara los policías. Y pidieron a una ambulancia que se lo llevara al hospital. Pero lamentablemente falleció mi hermano. Y al igual que mi hermano, hay muchas historias trágicas, muy tristes. Y de verdad, nosotros queremos que se haga justicia por todo lo que ha pasado.
Like Remedio, Marisol faced severe obstacles as she sought treatment for her husband. While his injury was not life-threatening, her husband's arm was left permanently damaged by a military bullet. For him and his family, surviving Sencata marked only the beginning of a long battle.
Que el día que lo operaron, lo hicieron sufrir mucho. Él se internó en el hospital holandés, donde los médicos de emergencia no lo quisieron atender. Simplemente agarraron y le dijeron, tú eres masista. Tú por 50 pesos te has hecho hacer, con tu papá Evo has curar. Entonces, yo en el auxilio no tenía ni un centavo cuando yo recibí la noticia de la herida de mi esposo. Así que no contaba con lo económico. No lo quisieron internar si es que yo no pagaba. Uno de los heridos que también había llegado fue quien su familiar me prestó dinero 250 para poder pagar la internación de mi esposo. Después de haberse internado en el hospital holandés, pues hemos sufrido demasiada discriminación, porque los doctores decían, por masista te ha pasado esto, porque eres, por tu papá Evo te has hecho hacer esto, ahora te aguantas con los 50 pesos que te han pagado que te cure. El doctor vino en hora de visita de los médicos y agarró y dijo, ustedes se hacen un lío por esto. Sacó su pañuelo, esto es, el ahuipala es como mi pañuelo, me limpio y lo boto y ustedes se hacen problema por esto. El día de la operación para mí es bien doloroso recordar eso, porque mi esposo ha entrado a la cirugía a las 9 de la mañana. Aproximadamente a las 11, 12 del mediodía ya mi esposo ya había sido operado. Pero lo han tenido como 3 horas gritando del dolor. Mi esposo, yo esperaba en la afuera de la sala de cirugías y mi esposo se escuchaba gritando. Él decía, ayúdenme, pónganme algún calmante, déanme algo, me duele. Estuvo 3 horas gritando así. Yo inclusive salí, compré un calmante de la farmacia. No le quisieron poner. El doctor que le operó salió. Le dije, doctor, póngale un calmante. Está gritando mi esposo, porque lo escuchábamos hasta afuera. Y el doctor decía, ¿qué voy a hacer? No le vamos a poner nada. Los camilleros, mi esposo no podía soportar el dolor, como no lo habían puesto en ningún tipo de calmante. Aún así, con el dolor, más lo maltrataban. Lo hacían chocar a propósito a las gradas, muy torpemente jaloneaban la camilla y mi esposo gritaba. Hubo un momento donde dijo mi esposo, ya no aguanto más, prefiero que me maten.
The experience left Marisol's husband permanently frightened of hospital visits. The discrimination he faced echoed a long history of anti-indigenous racism in Bolivia, which is often manifested in the form of military violence. The Sacaba and Sencata massacres were carried out within just the first week of the military's rule over Bolivia. The bloodshed brought back terrifying memories of the country's past, specifically a period known as Black October, when in 2003, Bolivia's indigenous and working class led massive strikes aimed at ousting the country's neoliberal president, Gonzalo Sánchez de Lozada, or Goni. Just as the Áñez-led junta did over 16 years later, Goni similarly unleashed the military upon those who dared to protest his rule, leading to the deaths of up to 81 people. Thomas Becker is part of the legal team that successfully sued Goni for the slaughter.
Sincata's always had this really historic space in social movements here in Bolivia. Historically, the indigenous have not been able to vote, or even when they were technically allowed to vote, they were really blockaded from voting. So what they've done historically here is protest. And one of the major sites of protest has been the Sincata plant, in part because it's, you know, where they transport in and out of the city, but as well, it's because it supplies the gas to major parts around La Paz. In Black October 2003, this was a big deal because in the upper class neighborhoods, people wanted their gas and they started to get upset. And the same thing happened recently in last year in 2019. You know, when the upper class was not getting their gas, things started to fall apart, at least for them, and it pressured the government to do something about it. What's significant about it, and frankly upsetting, is you know, after the 2003 protests, Black October really was seen as this really special time in which they kicked out this colonialist government. Goni, who was kind of the face of colonialism in Bolivia, he's known as El Gringo because his accent is somehow worse than my gringo accent.
Dejaron de pagar impuestos y comenzó a bajar los ingresos del Estado. Y sufrimos un daño muy grande. Entonces yo hablé con el presidente Bush y le pedí un apoyo de 150 millones y le dije que esto era muy, muy importante porque pensamos poder exportar gas a los Estados Unidos.
And so it was this new time. It kind of opened the space for Evo Morales to come in, for the social movements to really take charge. And so people thought we'd moved past that period of violence, of state violence like that. So when this happened in 2019 last year, it really kind of sent shockwaves throughout the country because people realized, okay, the economic elites here still use violence against indigenous people and have no problem with it.
The state repression unleashed on the people of Sencata by the Áñez government was not limited to the day of the massacre. In this shocking video, the military is seen tear gassing and breaking apart a peaceful funeral organized by family members of the victims of Sencata. In a separate attack, government forces tear gassed people gathered at the headquarters for victims' families. Remedio, Marisol, and others brutalized by the military government hope justice for the victims of Sencata and their families will be high on the agenda of the incoming government, led by Luis Arce and his Movement Towards Socialism party, slated to take power in early November. Within days of Mas's overwhelming victory, a commission formed within Bolivia's Plurinational Assembly announced it would charge Áñez and several of her government officials for the murders carried out under their watch.
Porque se tiene que hacer justicia con los muertos y los fallecidos en Sacaba, Sencata y otros. Por la investidura que se tiene, ¿no?, de presidenta transitoria, va a haber ese juicio de responsabilidades contra Yanine Áñez.
¿Ministros también se apuntan?
Sí, hay responsabilidades directas de los ministros, de las autoridades, quienes han estado en ejercicio de funciones y quienes han acribillado a las salteñas y alteños y a las personas cochabambinas, porque todas y todos tenemos los derechos y se tiene que respetar estos derechos.
¿Por qué sigo aquí? ¿Por qué tengo que seguir? Porque yo no quiero que se quede en vano, en nada, las lágrimas y el dolor. Y más que todo, el grito de mi esposo que decía, pónganme algo, me duele. Entonces, siempre cuando ya me siento cansada, cuando ya siento que no puedo seguir más, me acuerdo de eso. Y digo, no, tengo que seguir por él, por mis hijos, porque también ellos han sufrido. Y he visto llorar a mi hija. Yo la he encontrado. Un día he llegado y mi hija había estado llorando. Y mi mamá le pregunta, ¿por qué lloras, Dalina? Y mi hija le dice, si mi papá no hubiera estado vivo, ¿quién me hubiera cuidado?
Pero piensa que realmente fue trágico lo que ocurrió ahí. porque hay historias de, también de heridos que estuvieron en el lugar y son los testigos vivos del hecho. Dijeron que las balas pasaban de un lado a otro lado y nadie sabía cómo defenderse. Era algo desproporcional.
Yo realmente lo único que busco de todo esto es justicia. Es que paguen cada lágrima que mi familia ha derramado. Más que todo, mi esposo y mis hijos, es lo que quiero que paguen. Porque no es justo. No es justo que mis hijos se lleven ese recuerdo, ese mal momento, para toda su vida. Y es feo ver que mi hija odie a alguien. Y mi hija lo que dice es que yo odio a la Áñez. Y es una nena de 10 años. Y es feo yo me siento mal porque siento que yo le he transmitido eso a ella. Yo odio a la señora Áñez por lo que nos ha hecho. Entonces yo siento feo que ella lo haya agarrado de mí. Entonces, por eso es que seguimos y yo voy a seguir hasta el final para buscar justicia.